Well, good afternoon. For me, the Global Conference started last Thursday or Friday. So this is either day six or seven, and I've had to stay on planet Earth all those days. Now, finally, we get to think about what it would be like and why we should travel, particularly to Mars and parts of our solar system and to other solar systems. And there's no one better to tell us that than the person who was the second person to step on the moon. And I ordered to see how much you know. We have a question we want to ask, Buzz, before I introduce you. On July 20th, 1969, Buzz Aldrin and Neil Armstrong became the first human beings to walk on the moon. Armstrong stepped out first, followed 20 minutes later by Buzz. Why did Armstrong go first? No answers, Buzz, here. A, he was the mission commander and pulled rank. B, they flipped a coin. C, Armstrong was seated next to the hatch and Aldrin would have to climb over him in a bulky spacesuit. D, Aldrin said, "You go first. You look like you can use a little fresh air." And E, Aldrin was supposed to go first, but their boss, Slayton, changed the order after a briefing from President Nixon, who knew Armstrong. Okay, we're going to give you 15 to 20 seconds. Let's make a decision here. You're on the honor system today. Okay, time's up. All righty. How many believe the answer is A? Just raise your hand. Not one person, Buzz, thinks the answer is A in the room. No hands, I can see. B, they... B, they...
That's the reason.
They flipped a coin. Okay, a number of hands have gone up. C, Armstrong just happened to be seated next to the hatch. Okay, a few more. D, Aldrin said, Buzz said, "You go first. You look like you can use a little fresh air." A lot of people think you said that, Buzz. E, you were supposed to go first, but President Nixon intervened and moved Armstrong. Anyone believe that's true? Not one person. Okay, it seems like the number one answer is kind of somewhere between C and D. Let's see what the correct answer was. Okay, Buzz, tell us what it was like to be the second guy to step on the moon.
You will live the rest of your life being introduced as the second man on the moon. Now, the two of us could have switched positions. The hatch opened this way. So the person on the left can go out first. The person on the right can come over and go out. Either one of us could have moved there before we depressed the cabin. So you position whoever you want there, you depressurize the cabin, and the person there goes out. Now you have a failure. That person has to get back in again. That's failure number one. You close the hatch and you try and pressurize the cabin, but you have failure number two. You can't pressurize the cabin. Whoever's on this side is going to stay on that side. That's where the commander's controls are. That's where everything has been trained with the commander, just like any airliner is on. You have to turn yourself around on the left side. Two failures. dictated or established that the decision was correct, which means the commander, symbolically of any endeavor, is this symbolic person who should do the event that the public, history, everything else expects. That does not mean...
Let me make a point, Buzz. We're going to start this one over again. The first living person that stepped on the moon, Buzz Aldrin.
Oh, I was the first alien to leave another object to return to Earth.
All right, so let me switch over to Yuri. Yuri, what's your passion? What is driving you to send us to another star? Interstellar travel. What has driven you in this interest?
Well, I think one of the most exciting discoveries of the last 10 years is that we have a lot of planets orbiting other stars that look pretty much like our planet. And the latest estimates that I have heard from the experts is about 100 billion planets just in our galaxy alone. And then the latest estimate of galaxies is about a trillion. So 100 billion has to be multiplied by a trillion. So it's a big number. And to believe now, when we have those facts, that we are absolutely alone in the universe is a little bit an aggressive assumption. So once we realize that the possibilities are there, then we need to put our heads together and decide what we do about it and what kind of research we need to do to find out, in fact, whether there is other life in the universe, including in some places in our solar system. I think that's a very exciting possibility. And I think in the next 10, 20 years, we will really start getting answers to those questions.
Can we take a look at that, maybe that short animation, and you could maybe explain it to us why we looked at it, Yuri, first?
Sure.
Okay, let's see if we can pull that up.
Well, this is a realistic possibility that we're looking into right now with a lot of experts participating, how you can travel a few orders of magnitude faster than we can right now using a laser beam from the ground and the space sail, pretty much similar to how we traveled a few hundred years ago across the ocean, but now only in space. And some calculations show that you can accelerate a few grams of a spaceship to about 20% of speed of light, and at that speed it will take about 20 years to get to the nearby star, which is called Alpha Centauri. And incidentally, a planet that can harbor life was recently discovered orbiting one of the stars of that system. So the ideas of that sort of propulsion have been discussed for about 50 years, but only in the last 10 years it really became realistic to have an engineering discussion around this possibility. And we believe that we need to invest, and I committed personally $100 million in the next few years to investigate this opportunity.
Yuri, do these lasers exist, such massive lasers today?
Say it again.
Do the lasers exist that could do this today?
Yes, so these lasers do exist. And you need to put together a few million of them and synchronize them in a certain way. But we've made significant progress in laser technology in the last 10, 15 years. And the cost of lasers is on a similar Moore's type curve, as we have seen with the processors.
So is there a problem of what this sale could encounter along the way? Space dust, radiation, other types of things traveling at that speed.
Yeah, so we have been working with a lot of some of the best scientists in various areas, and we have identified about 20 technical challenges that you would need to overcome to make this happen. You mentioned one of them, which is interstellar dust. And the estimates, the best estimates that we have right now, that it is possible to overcome this challenge. And even more so that you will be able to launch those tiny spaceships pretty much every day. And the cost of each one of them is going to be very low. So if you lose 90% of them, it can still be a successful endeavor.
How does this tie in, this breakthrough effort here on the Starshot? How does it tie in with your other effort of listening from space?
Yeah, so together with Stephen Hawking, we announced 2 years ago a sort of resurrection of a project that used to be called SETI, Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. And we are now funding probably the most ambitious project in that space, which is 1,000 times more efficient than any other previous search. And our goal is to look at 1 million nearby stars and 100 nearby galaxies in the next 10 years and see if we will see any signal from any one of those objects, whether it be in the radio spectrum or in the optical spectrum as well.
All right. Buzz, you're wearing a shirt today, aren't you? You changed your shirt.
No, I...
Because I saw a T-shirt before that you were walking around with. Get your ass to Mars.
Now, that was a line taken from Arnold Schwarzenegger in Total Recall, and he gave me permission to use that.
Okay, but isn't that a call to action for all of us? Don't you want us to mobilize to get to Mars?
Absolutely, for a nation that led the world, inspired the world in space 40-some years ago. We cannot even put a human being into space to a space station that we, the American people, paid about $100 billion for. We have to hitch a ride on a Russian spacecraft. So you are contributing to the advancement of Roscosmos, the Soviet, the Russian space program. Every time we send one of our astronauts to the International Space Station, I think it's time to change.
So, Dan, you ran NASA. You and I had a lot of work to do in education, 2002, 2003, and 2004. And it's kind of, I don't understand why we haven't gone to Mars since 1972. And I don't understand why we don't have the leadership to get us ready to go to Mars. What have you been doing? What are you working on?
I tried to do a Mars mission twice. One in the late 60s and early 70s, and that didn't happen, because Vietnam happened. And then I got asked by President George H.W. Bush to come back to NASA and do a Mars mission. And at the time, the NASA team said it would cost $330 billion. I told them I thought I could do it for at least an order of magnitude less.
Did you?
I didn't have the opportunity because the Cold War ended, Buzz. and it was necessary to have a mission with the Russians. And there was a great concern that the Russians would be selling missiles to Iran, Iraq, and North Korea. Wouldn't it be better to build a space station with the Russians than create difficulty on the planet? So I lost my second Mars mission. I then decided when I left NASA the second time, in 2001, that there was a bigger mission ahead I would come back to space later. I believe that the future for the well-being, health, and productivity of humanity on Earth depends upon a partnership between humans and machines. And that partnership should allow anyone, anywhere, in any device to be able to take advantage of it without being in a big company so that they can improve the quality of their lives. I set up a company. We're building the world's most powerful cloud that's going to be accessible to anyone, anywhere, on any place, on any device in this earth.
What's the name of that company?
It happens to be New Edge, with a K, silent.
So, May, you've been an astronaut, you're a scientist, doctor, many fields of science you've been involved in. Why did you join Yuri on Starshot Initiative? And also, can you explain to us what the 100-year Starship is?
So I can start off by saying that the reason why I was really excited to work with Starshot is because it's about moving human presence further. So here's the thing. I believe that pursuing an extraordinary tomorrow is what creates a better world today. Right now, there are a lot of problems in this world that we're approaching very incrementally, right? But the reality is that we have to solve these right now. The thing that I took away from my space flight was that this planet that's here is incredible. But we always say, save the Earth. The issue isn't saving the Earth. The issue is, how do we survive as a species on this planet? And in order to do that, we have to change some things. We first of all have to push harder on our capabilities so that we won't overgrow the carrying capacity for us, right? So we have to learn a lot more about sustainability, a lot more about how do we behave with one another. We have to understand a lot more about this machine connection, but what that means to be human. There's so many things that we have to do, and so many real radical leaps in technology and human systems that we have to make, that we can't do it by using just a small incremental approach. We have to do something big. So 100-year Starship was seed funded by DARPA. I led the team that won the seed funding to make sure that the capabilities for human travel beyond our solar system to another star exist within 100 years. Notice that I didn't say that there was a mission date where we were going to have a starship, but the capabilities. And what do I mean by capabilities? I mean that it's not just energy and propulsion, which is really very, very important. It's more than that. It's also things like human health. In fact, that's one of the big issues. How do we make sure that we can keep humans healthy? And we have to connect it to life back here on Earth. So our proposal was titled An Inclusive Audacious Journey Transforms Life Here on Earth and Beyond. So inclusion was the first word. I would come up and say that when we start to look at how do we keep humans healthy, we started a project called Virtual Human, which was how to wholly model human health and physiology. So that we would start to look at and say, it's not just about microgravity. It's about how do you create a whole new health infrastructure that you can take into deep space with you. Because we're not going to be able to take up enough pills and all that kind of stuff. So if we could go to partially along the way of creating this kind of health infrastructure that's based on modeling, epidemiology, microbiology, all of those kinds of things, then it has an incredible impact here on Earth. And then the last thing I want to add, just in terms of why 100-year Starship, is because that whole thing about why did we not continue on the moon? Why didn't we go to Mars? As a little girl, I assumed that I would be on Mars when I got to be old enough to be an astronaut. I just, you know, I was going to be there. That didn't happen. But I remember that everybody wasn't included. Folks love space exploration, but I remember in my neighborhood as a little kid running around trying to tell people on the south side of Chicago how come it was so important for us to go to the moon. But yet we left so many people out. And that's what we have to do. The way we got to virtual human is because we brought people in who had never been involved in space exploration, but who had this incredible expertise. And they came up with a different way of looking at things. But even more than that, we have to have public commitment to do these things. Widespread public commitment. And you get that by including more people. And that's what 100 Year Starship is really about. It's about how do we get more people involved over a period of time with space exploration, whether it's from the point of view of religion, social sciences, medicine, propulsion, microbiomes, getting people involved across ethnicity, gender, culture, geography. How do we get this effort going?
Dan, two things strike me. One, when I interacted with you a number of years ago, we were very focused on biology, and if we're going to send a person to Mars, it's a long journey. We don't know if they're coming back, but if they got sick along the way, we'd have to figure out how to deal with that issue. You might just think back to why that didn't continue to the extent it did, that somewhat that May just mentioned. And the second area that we've thought about was, what role can private industry play? I had the honor with Governor Schwarzenegger and Al Gore and others to go over to JPL when the Mars rover was landing and watch the simulation as it did and watch the different crews, one group getting into Earth orbit, one from Earth into Mars orbit, one to get it on the ground, et cetera, cheering as they met their objectives from that standpoint. So, what is the issue? What has occurred? Why haven't we fired up that Mars mission of yours again? And how much capital do you think you need? And how long would it be before we could actually seriously consider putting someone on Mars, in your opinion? I'm going to go to Buzz next.
I love my country, but the government costs too much and takes too long. And that we've got to be able to do it at this point in time. The technology, the government is terrific at invention and pushing the boundaries. But if someone came to me today and said, I'll give you some tens of billions of dollars, not hundreds, in 6 years, I'd launch to Mars. I think it's within our grasp. As a species, we can't just sit here looking through telescopes, which has to be done, because we want to see if there's life around other stars, planets around other stars. But we've been sitting on this planet. I started working on a Mars mission in 1962. We were working with nuclear power and plasma propulsion. 1962, we were thinking about missions to Mars in 1979. I got disgusted and I left NASA because the bureaucracy got involved. It needs to be too safe. The media needs to know what's the torque on the screw on that part of the vehicle. We got to do it with private funding. There's loads of cash around. Now, the government could do the infrastructure, the communications links, the medicine that has to be done. A lot of good medicine has to be done. This, too, could be done. Building HAL, that has to happen. I'm going to do that. But all these things could be done by the government, but I am hoping there are a few billionaires come together and go do it just for the sake of doing it, not for the damn science. Just go do it to make it happen.
So, Dan, I just wanted
to... Just go there once.
I didn't say go there once. Just go... Everything doesn't have to be a big, long plan. Do it, because all we ever do in America is debate, and we go to Congress, and we look for money. What Yuri's doing is the right thing.
Well, there is a very successful company located in Portland, Oregon, that has a motto, just do it. Okay, so called Nike.
Good advertisement.
Now, Buzz, you want us to go to Mars, you want us to stay, you want us to colonize the planet. What is your vision, and what do we need to do it in your lifetime?
I'd love to debate you, but I don't want to use up time to do that. And I don't want to just explain things. I have things written down, and I'll try and do it fast, and I hope you can understand. I spent the last 30 years of my life developing a plan that will get people to Mars by 2039. And we can get there to stay with a permanent human presence on Mars. No flags and footprints this time. We need a presidential commitment at the 50th anniversary of Neil stepping on the moon, July 20th, 2019. Fiscal discipline is what has to be done to make this happen. We can afford to go to Mars, but we must have fiscal discipline. We must focus our resources on only those things that are really necessary to get to Mars. In my view, we are currently spending over $6 billion on programs that we do not need to get to Mars. So we need fiscal discipline, we need reusability, we need evolutionary development, and we need U.S. leadership. We need a global lunar Mars coalition. Will include the major players, including the U.S., Europe, Russia, India, Japan, and China, as well as emerging space actors like UAE, South Korea, and Saudi Arabia. We need a commercial supply of lunar propellants. Sustainable permanence through cycling pathways to occupy Mars, CPOM, will reduce the cost of sending a person to Mars by an order of magnitude over traditional expeditionary ways. It develops. It begins with the development of a commercial replacement for the ISS. Not continue it forever, which Congress and vested interests would like to do. We must retire the ISS as soon as possible. We simply cannot afford $3.5 billion a year of that cost. We need to replace it with the commercially developed modules, and there are already two companies considering contributing to this, the Bigelow Aerospace Company, Inflatables, and a company called Axiom. Now, I want these companies to develop with a space hab core the first generations of cycling spacecraft that will ultimately take people from Earth to the Moon and Mars. I call them LEO cyclers, low Earth orbit cyclers. Orion can become a permanent safe haven for emergency crew return from a LEO commercial cycler. We need to develop a cislunar cycler. A second version of the cycling spacecraft begins with transitioning the second LEO cycler, low Earth orbit cycler, into a lunar cycler orbit, which orbits between the Earth and the Moon. An Orion intercept of this cycler that is unmanned will provide the safe haven in lunar orbit. A third LEO cycler can be accelerated into an Earth-Moon cycling orbit once a month, three swing-bys of the Earth and one of the Moon. This will provide space tourists with the opportunity to travel between the Earth and the Moon in relative luxury. Now, the early mission, but the mission of the lunar cycler in lunar orbit will be to oversee the development and operation of lunar fuel refueling all landers that go there. So they just go up and down, five, six, however many we need. And then from this orbit, we also construct the infrastructure on the surface, the base assembly. Once these surface systems and operations have been developed, they will become commercially operated and owned, using lunar-based propellants to fuel reusable lunar landers and tankers, will revolutionize in-space transportation between the Earth and the Moon and Mars. Commercially provided low-cost transportation in LEO and the Moon will enable a robust international research community on the surface of the Moon. My friend, Dr. Jan Werner, Director General of the European Space Agency, calls this Moon Village.
All right, now
international partners.
Let's slow down. We want to give the other three people a little chance here. So let's hold it there for just one moment.
Mike, can I do something?
May you want to engage?
I just want to put a little bit of this stuff in perspective. So when we start talking about what do we do in space and how do we do it, let's think about the generations to come. There's a Martinican psychiatrist named Frantz Fanon who said, each generation must, out of relative obscurity, discover its mission, fulfill it, or betray it. When we think about what's going on now, we talk about maybe we're going to Mars, and I would love to go to Mars. I'd go to Mars in a heartbeat, at a drop of a hat. Mars is something that we need to do. It's necessary, but it's not sufficient to really push us hard enough. If we start to think about all these things we talk about, for the majority of people who are alive on Earth, we have been on Mars since they were born. And so in terms of pushing us hard enough, it doesn't do that. I think it's really incredible. I want to go, and I think that Mars is a part of it, but we need to do it very rapidly. So saying we could go to Mars in 6 years is one of those things that galvanizes us that would be able to make us move forward. Mars has been 25 years away for how many years?
Since 62.
It's been, and so it's really about, if we said we were going back to the Moon, let's go back to the Moon in 5 years and establish
and
a Moon base.
In the decade, and we made it.
These are things we need to do. So when you asked me why was I so excited about what Yuri was doing, because just think about how everybody alive now, we have never been to another star. So even though I push on humans because it makes the project more difficult, getting to another star and to be able to see Alpha Centauri is something that's galvanizing, that pushes us harder. And then we're able to really take advantage of the incredible commitment and energy and resources that come with trying a difficult project. And the other thing I would add, and Dan, you maybe can put a part on this, is that what we saw during the Apollo era was this incredible increase in the number of people who went into the sciences, even if they weren't going into space. We saw this incredible increase in the money that came into, or the economic growth that we had, even though it wasn't necessarily all from space. So this is really about how do we, as Earthlings, like really push on something that's going to get us in a better place. And it's all of the above. It's the Moon, it's Mars, but it's doing it in such a way that it's bold and it moves us beyond where we are right now.
Well, May, I would say after Sputnik went up and a call went out around America, NASA was formed, DARPA was formed, et cetera. If 20 years later you went over to Lockheed, you would have found and asked them why they were a physicist, a mathematician, or whatever, an astrophysicist, more than 50% would have said because of Sputnik or Sputnik Uri. So there was a call to action. There was a dream, something to follow. As Buzz said, president said, we're going to be on the moon in 10 years, and you beat it. And I think what you're saying is, Mars, yes, but we need a bigger call to action. Yuri, when you and I talk about this, I really think about two things. And Buzz is one of the few people that ever saw Earth from the moon. First, we have this unbelievable planet that we need to protect. It is the home to this race that evolved over billions of years. Will anyone in the universe ever know we even existed on those trillions of potential planets out there? And so, one, we have to protect our own starship, Earth, at all costs. And two, ultimately, there is some probability greater than zero that you would tell us, Yuri, that something could happen to this planet. And if something could happen to this planet, it could also happen to our solar system. So ultimately, the perpetuation of human beings that we even existed, it seems to me, calls us to move to another star system, at least to look. What is it that drives you every day in this area? So that's what makes me wish that you would solve this problem so I don't have to work on it.
Well, one of the effects of this amazing space race that started in the late 50s was that a lot of boys who were born in Russia were called Yuri, after the first man in space. And I was actually...
Do you know any of those boys that were called Yuri?
I was actually one of them, and I was born in the same year that Yuri Gagarin was launched, and I basically came to realize that this was some sort of a message that that was sent to me and maybe to our generation, that we need to think about the next step. And the next step could be Mars, and this will be a great step. The next step could be finding Earth on, you know, Europa or Enceladus in our solar system, or finding life on one of those exoplanets that have been discovered in great numbers recently. So I think all these things, they open exciting possibilities, and any one of those discoveries, as I agree with May, can have an impact on our, you know, business here on this planet, because, you know, just knowing that we're not alone is a very powerful thing. And of course, it can have two effects. Either it can get us energized and or scared, and then we it will be sort of a call to action. Or we, on the other hand, can feel a little bit relaxed, because even if something happens here, there is somebody out there, and the universe will take care of itself that way. But I think one way or the other, whether we're alone or not alone, knowing one of those outcomes is pretty exciting.
So, Dan, when I think about this issue, there's been dozens of movies where some alien from outer space attacks Earth and unites the people on Earth to bond together to fight that alien, and having us recognize that we have something in common with our planet Earth, and there's something out there that threatens us, so we come together to fight it. One of the areas that seems to me that you have a great deal of knowledge in that has piqued this interest are telescopes that allow us to see, image, etc., to get people excited. So the fact that this planet exists lets us better understand Yuri's vision to send something to the nearest star. What could we do in the way of telescopes today to give the people, not just of the United States, of Earth, a better view, a better understanding of what's out there and how we could interact with it?
Thank you for asking that question, because I believe, in addition to having productive and healthy lives, we need to be stimulated by higher order things. And one is, are we alone? You could go back into ancient writing and see the people looking up at the heavens and wondering it. But before I say that, you were worried about aliens bringing the people together. I think there are enough aliens on Earth to bring together. Even in our own country. But in any case, telescopes have really progressed to the point where we have the power. We know there are planets around other stars. There are a variety of techniques. One technique is to take a star shield. I was just at the Jet Propulsion Lab Thursday this week. It's 100 feet in diameter. It's built to incredible precision, and they place the spacecraft 33,000 kilometers away, and the star shield blocks out the glare from the star so you could actually see the planet. So rather than just inferring it, you could actually see it. The next step is to take high-resolution pictures with an interferometer. This is taking a number of telescopes, and you separate them out spatially, and you know the exact distance between them. So instead of getting the shape, the size of one telescope, you get a big size. And now, what if we could have pictures of oceans and continents and mountain ranges and clouds? And then the final step is you get spectrometers, and you look at the chemical species inside of those atmospheres on those planets, and if it's at a thermal equilibrium, we got life. This is all achievable within a 15 to 20 year period maximum. And the thing that I would love, Yuri gets a few of his buddies together, they throw in a few billion dollars.
A few.
No, I'm dead serious. He's got it. We'll shake him upside down. It'll come out of his pockets. But seriously, he's not happy. But we can't just have government control from government agencies funding people. And many times it takes too long because they want you to prove it could be done before you do it.
Right.
I love the idea of bringing in people of wealth to stimulate the process. So, Yuri, I'll help you get your friends. I don't have the cash yet, but I'll work with you.
Well, I think we've already seen this trend. And whether it's Jeff Bezos, whether it's Elon Musk, whether it's a friend in the UK or others around the world today, there are others that aren't waiting, okay? And they're focused here on getting us to Mars and or getting us to the moon and making it commercial in that process. And based on their past success, I have no reason to deny. Dan, one of the things that has struck me is that when we talked about sequencing the human genome, we talked, when it was successful, about all the things we've learned and what the unbelievable value is today with understanding the genome and sequencing and mutations, et cetera. Since you were there, maybe Buzz also, and maybe all the panelists, could we just spend a couple minutes, maybe 1 minute each, telling us what have been the spin-offs, the science that has come out of the space program to date? Dan, why don't you start us out?
Where could I begin? Semiconductors. Communication systems. If you get a satellite TV, that comes from programs started at NASA. If you take a look at a variety of digital imaging that helps us in looking at X-rays, NASA, and the partnership, there's another critical element, at least in America, the partnership between the research agencies is unbelievable. And in the 10 years I was there, I had the privilege of working with the director of National Institutes of Health. So technology goes back and forth. In fact, if you read the Space Act of 1957, President Eisenhower anticipated this and said, while we're going to go out into space, we want to make sure that we could harvest all the science and technology that comes out of it. So most things that we are exposed to, a lot of the funding comes from NASA, but it's a cross coordination. And you and I worked on prostate cancer in the early 90s.
And it's correct. Buzz, your minute. What did you use? And by the way, Buzz, if someone wants to read and fully understand your strategy here, is there a magazine or is there a website they could go to look at? They have to go to your head?
Listen to me.
Okay. So we're going to give them your email and location, because I don't think they're going to get in just a few minutes what you've shown us here, which is so exciting. What, when you were involved in this space effort as an astronaut, et cetera, what do we use on Earth today, in your opinion, that was deployed to make it work for you on your mission?
I think it's an understanding of what is needed to carry out a particular task. We need a location, we need a time, and we need a plan. President Kennedy gave us a location, the moon. He gave us a time. We did not have a plan. That came afterward, and the process of getting that plan involved a very inventive engineer who had a better scheme than Dr. Von Braun of the Marshall Space Flight Center, who wanted a big rocket, a big spacecraft that would go to the moon and do everything and come back. This engineer said, you must split that up into pieces. You need a crew, spacecraft, you need a support system, and it will go to the moon. When you go to the moon, you take with you a stage that can land and a crew that can go on top of that, leave that descent stage there, come back up in the ascent stage, rendezvous with your friend. Oh, that's dangerous. Then you come home. You leave all that stuff up there. Without the plan called Lunar Orbit Rendezvous, we would not have been successful in Apollo. It is a plan that makes the difference.
Okay, so we're going to try to develop a plan here. Since Buzz was on the moon, since Dan ran NASA May, you're in the time of people's time frame has become shorter and shorter. They ask a question of Google, and you expect an answer in seconds. So as I see your plan, if we're successful, 20 years to develop the technology, 20 years to get there if we've developed technology, 4 years to get that information back, since we're not going to fully discuss how we can travel faster than the speed of light. We'll leave that for another panel. So let me think that. If I add that up, that's 44 years. Now, I'm going to be 115 then. And so my question to you, if people's time frame is shorter, how do we get people behind an idea that would last 44 years, and in your case, 100 years? We got to get them behind that idea. And when we get there, what are we going to learn?
Well, I guess we need to learn from our ancestors who lived 200 years ago, and they were building cathedrals for a few hundred years. And somehow they kept this motivation and just kept building. And they left to us this amazing buildings as the memory and as an artifact of their commitment, long-term commitment. So I think, you know, if there is a powerful idea, it will kind of perpetuate itself. And I think that as more and more people realize our responsibility not only to citizens of this planet, but also our responsibility vis-a-vis our galaxy and the whole universe, I think more and more people will get behind those exciting initiatives, starting with Mars and then going beyond.
So let me ask you a question, Yuri. You're one of the few people in this room that actually collaborated with Stephen Hawking. What is that experience like?
Well, he's an incredible human being. He, you know, given his condition, he is absolutely unique. I mean, there is maybe one person like that in a billion, given everything that he was able to achieve, given his condition. And that's why, you know, he, although he cannot say much, given the constraints of his ability to communicate, it makes it so much more valuable when we hear some words of wisdom from him, including his endorsement of our initiative.
May, you were a young girl, and I actually dreamed of space as a young boy. And I wanted to leave with the audience or anyone watching this online. If you ever have to dream, there are so many things on the web you can go to just to think about how large our universe is and how many universes there are and how many different galaxies. And it's just hard to believe that we are the only, what we know as life, that's been created on these billions of planets. How come you haven't been out there marching in Washington to get this going?
So, two things. I haven't been marching, but I've been dedicated the past 5 years of my life and what minor resources I have, as well as trying to galvanize and get other people involved in this particular endeavor. I have been doing it. So we march in different ways. And so everywhere I go, I talk about 100 Year Starship. I talk about the need to really push further. I talk about Breakthrough Starshot. I talk about why Mars is necessary, but it's not sufficient. I talk about how we connect with things, that, you know, this inclusive, audacious journey to transform life here on Earth and beyond. But I want to go to something you asked. You asked about
my march was a figurative thing. And
so I've been marching all the time. I'm marching all the time. I want to go to something you asked about, the impact of space exploration. I'm looking out here and everybody has a smartphone in their hand, right? And so everybody asked Bertha or whoever to tell me where to go and how to get to someplace, right? So we have a global positioning satellite system. You have a space receiver in your hand. It is so commonplace that it's almost difficult for us to even talk about the pieces. The idea of miniaturization from the Apollo program, there was a real push because you had to have smaller kinds of items for less space weight. So it's part of us. It's part of who we think of. We do arms treaties. It's impossible to even talk about many things in life without it. But what we don't do is to recognize how much a part of us this is and what we need to do and why it's important for us as citizens not to say, hey, Yuri, you fund all of this, but that we have to put our time and energy and money into it. So, Dan, we usually agree on a lot of things, and I do agree that we want to have lots of people involved if we can get folks to put funding in it, but 100 Year Starship, we have a T-shirt that says, space isn't just for rocket scientists and billionaires. I throw my hat in there with the rocket scientists because we all need to be working on this. So what, if we start to think about what happens in the world today, I don't think $3 billion is too much to spend on International Space Station. That's a drop in the hat compared to how much money we spend on other things as a society in the United States and in the world. We could do a lot more with less money, but it's not too much. And so I would do this juxtaposition of the one thing that we have to do is to move forward as a species and as a society. There's one thing that we have. We all need an adrenaline rush. You know, some of us are more adrenaline junkies than others, like, but we all need challenges in the world. We all need to push ourselves and we need stress. So how come we don't find something that's a global ambition that pushes us harder, that allows us to do this collectively as a society of humans so that we're not like manufacturing stress, which is what we do right now. There are things that we can do that push us hard enough so that as we evolve as a species, we have to figure out how to go further. So I think that we should actually be pushing for funding that comes from all different places. It's not just saying, hey, we have to let, say, one group of people does it. All of us have benefited from it, and we should demand from ourselves and from our governments and everything that they invest in things that are really important, and we should move ahead. We shouldn't sit back and say, hey, there's nothing they can do. Some of the programs may be overbloated. We may have to decrease the way we work on things, but we shouldn't be complacent and just allow it to devolve into something that we're not benefiting from.
May, I just want to be clear. I am not against the government funding.
No, I understand.
But the need, competition is what creates a stress. It's a creative stress. And I lived for 10 years with all the people that wanted, that looked upon NASA as a good high-tech jobs.
Yeah.
NASA is not about good high-tech jobs. NASA is about inspiration.
Absolutely.
For America and the world.
Boldness.
And that's got to be brought under control.
It has to be about boldness, but we do that by involving more people. I think a big part of our issue is that we go to the same people all the time and that we don't include a greater swath of folks and let them become engaged. And that's what we need to do as we engage more. I know about Breakthrough Starshot has gone out and engaging lots of different people. We talk about how do we do outreach to include more folks. That's what we can do with the web. Those are the things we need to do something bigger.
Dan, to underline the point you just made, the two people that sequenced the human genome, Francis Collins and Craig Venter, are both here. And Francis was representing the government and working for them. Craig went commercial on his efforts. And the fact that they had competition and Craig was moving speeded up the entire process. I don't feel this is dollars. The world has tens of trillions of dollars. And there's over $10 trillion that's invested at a minus rate. And so this, I think we can find a solution for. And I want to come back to you, Buzz. We need a plan. I think people, it's amorphous. What is the plan? What is the goal? And Yuri, if we're doing this for subsequent generations, what are we leaving for them? I think that clear message. Could you articulate that message? Let's just say it's three or four generations. What will we have left them if we made this investment?
Well, I think it's really about recognizing the incredible opportunity that was given to us, because we know that there are so many planets and we know that all of them, you know, many of them don't have life. So we have been incredibly lucky to be able to have life and intelligence. And now it's our responsibility to use this intelligence to A, survive, and then expand. I think it's as simple as that. And as soon as we all recognize this responsibility and pass it to the next generation, I think that would be a pretty good job if we can do that.
Much of the work that we've seen over the last couple of decades tells us that an individual gets interested in science somewhere by 12. If you haven't gotten them interested by 12 years old, they might not be interested later in their career. If I asked you, Dan, how young were you when you got interested in...
7.
Buzz, how old were you when you got interested?
I had my first airplane ride at age 2.
Okay. May?
I don't even remember when I got interested. I always assumed I'd be in science.
Yuri?
I was 8 when Mr. Aldrin landed on the moon.
So I think one of the things you can see from this panel is they all have passion. Both Dan and Buzz want to get to Mars as soon as possible. They feel it's a jumping point from that standpoint. Buzz has his plan. And if it's okay with you, Buzz, we're going to give him an email to communicate okay. on that. But it's very hard if you step back and think about this unbelievable chain of events that has caused, as Yuri said, us to develop as human beings, our intellect, our knowledge. And it's really hard to believe that with a trillion planets in multiple universes, that just by sheer accident and mutations, that something else didn't occur. And Yuri, my great-grandchildren are going to thank you for showing the way for us to get there, unless I can figure out how in that movie Passenger we can kind of put ourselves to sleep for 100 years to wake up. So I want to thank you for joining us. I hope that the group has perked your interest in this area and realized how we are just a little speck in the universe. And those pictures from Saturn back at Earth show you we're just a little dot. And that's, as we know, the only place that living beings at the moment exist. And our quest to find others throughout the universe is a quest we need to follow up. And there's that little speck, which is Earth there between the moons of Saturn. And so I can think of no way better. You want to say something, Buzz, before we... Okay, Buzz?
When our country was formed, we communicated by Pony Express. The Indians did better. They had smoke signals that went at the speed of light. World War I, we used carrier pigeons. We are communicating in the electromagnetic spectrum. I know some very advanced people who believe that our search for extraterrestrial intelligence by radio frequencies is the wrong way to do it. Gravity waves, high frequency gravity waves. One can surf with changing the gravity in front and the gravity behind a spacecraft. Don't ask me how. I do know that Arthur Clarke said, my fictitious use of zero point energy was innovative thinking. High frequency gravity waves. How can we be so sure that everything we're using today will be how we do things in the future? There will be major breakthroughs and we're not even thinking about them. But if we want to do something, we need a destination that the public, we need a time to get there. And you don't go to Mars without going to the moon, bringing in international partners, learning how to refuel, how to build things there, so you know how to do things remotely at Mars. You need this kind of a plan to bring the partners together. I have Yuri, that plan.
I'm sure Yuri has listened well, since he is funding right now the most ambitious program ever, Buzz, to listen to outer space today.
I cannot argue with my hero here. So.
So Leonard Nimmo couldn't be with us tonight to close, unfortunately. But his voice is to remind us of the human spirit and why we want to go where no one has ever gone before.